Knowledge. Okay, why will that benefit a development team? Why will that benefit a software engineering development team? Also, how can you provide support for software engineers? So the difference here with this course is that you're all technical. Okay, you're all technical, good. You must be good. You're at Manchester, so it's a good course. So you must be good technical people. Okay. However, once you become user experience specialist, if that's what you go on to be, you'll need to be the bridge, if you like, between people who have got software engineering and good technical experience and actual user experience people, or people with a maybe more social science, sociology user experience skill set. You'll need to be able to understand the issues that both people are talking about and change those and be able to be the conduit for those issues. Okay. The other thing that's important is code has beauty, okay? So any software engineer, any coder will I think immediately agree on this, but code has beauty. Now, you might say to yourself, well, why do I care about this? Why do I care about the beauty of the implementation? Code as an implementation, okay? Why does that matter? It matters because it affects the user experience. And as an example, what's this that we can see with this? Apple Newton. So if that's an old, that's from the past, it's retro chic, vintage now. Who has heard of Apple Newton? Oh, a few people. Oh, awesome dudes, yes. So, I've seen people even using to this day, it's retro, it's back. Okay, so what? So the Apple News, what was it? Who wants to tell me what the Apple News actually was? Yes, Apple's attempt at making tablet with a stylus, but it predated everything else, right? Well, yeah. Lots of other stuff. So this was out, what, 1990, maybe? Okay, so they're doing this tablet computer and way before. It did also have cursive script recognition, so you could just write on the screen and you could translate that to print, you know, to text. So to do cursive script recognition, which was interesting. Not necessarily very well. But the thing that made this different from user experience is that the engineers were good. They saw what they did as important. And so what they did was have a data store called a soup. Who's heard of a soup data store? Who's heard of a NoSQL database? Oh yes, Mungo, DB, Couch, DB. Okay, so these are where you're just pushing objects into the collection. Those objects can be described actually as part of the objects. So, this was a kind of version of that in a way, that the soup, all of the applications pushed their data into this shared soup. But that, you might think, well, that sounds a bit weird, you know, everything's all together, that doesn't sound very relational databasing. And that's okay, it wasn't meant to be. But what it did allow is that any application could access the data from any other application. Okay? So if you were in the calendar, you didn't need to do anything special about knowing that it was somebody's birthday from the address book, because the calendar had access to the address book, and they had access to the date of birth from the address book, because all the data was in the soup. Okay? And the same is true for when you wrote a document, if you wrote a document or a note, all those notes would appear under the contact details of the user in the address book, because it's just a soup data store. All they have to do is say, I'm deciding to display to you this bit of information because I can get it from the soup. Yeah? Nothing special needs to be done. And this is really important. If they hadn't have done that, then they would never have got the user traction at that time that they did. Okay? The user experience on these was outstanding. And lots of people bought into Apple because of the Newton. Okay? Even back in the 90s, people bought into the user experience and bought into this. Even now, you can get, people love this so much, you can get one of these as a ROM, okay, to fit it to your own piece of, you know, to your own. I've seen iPads running Newton OS, okay, because people like them better than iPads. So that's how committed the people are to the user experience. So they've bought into this user experience because software engineers thought that this was important. Okay, that had a knock-on effect. Just like what? Connect two pieces of the course together that you've heard today. Just like our MP3 work. The MP3 work was about really seemed to be about compression, having good compression. But it affected the user experience, just like having good data storage affected the user experience. So good software engineering, good coders affect the user experience, even if that building that user experience isn't at the interface level. Okay? There we are. That's why you're saying good creative software engineers create a good user experience. Just like I said. Okay, so this is a user-centric design methodology. It's slightly different, very easy from a guy called Stephen Whitaker. So Stephen Whitaker is quite a famous human computer interaction guy. He's at the University of California, Santa Cruz. Okay, so he's there. And this is a very straightforward guy. But the thing that's different here is understanding users. Okay, so understanding users starts. So understanding users goes to design, goes to system building, goes to evaluation, goes back to understanding users. After the evaluation, we understand more about people. Okay? And that leads into better life cycle of the project. And then we get the final product that goes out. So this is a very straightforward methodology. Okay? The thing that you should think about this methodology is that it's meant to be run multiple times. Okay? In the real world, it wouldn't be run multiple times. So, let's have a look at other kind of So, waterfall. Who wants to tell me about waterfall? You already know. You know the waterfall. Model, do you? Life cycle. Waterfall. Yes. One person knows the waterfall. Software engineering. Any other people know what the waterfall? Yes, a few others. Okay, good. Waterfall. So, what do you think waterfall is good for? In the agile world of new development, what is waterfall good for?
Nothing.
Good for nothing. Waterfall is good for nothing. Okay.
Relatively small projects.
Relatively small projects. Okay. Yeah.
Building things like radar systems where your requirements are very unlikely to change or are impossible to change.
So building things like radar systems where your requirements are very unlikely to change, that's true. Any others that comes back to that?
Eurocentric projects in your small room.
Eurocentric projects in your small room? I'm glad you're rubbing your hands there like Ebenezer Scrooge. Yes, I own a good project. Okay, anything else? What about safety critical? Do you think waterfall is good for safety critical? Or do you think we all ought to be agile and just, you know, change things? Oh, release early and get version 0.5 out, because if we have one, that should be fine. We'll fix it in 6. Yeah.
It depends if the kind of user experience of the user isn't good in a safety critical system. That can create things like increased workload and thus cause safety issues.
That's right. So these things can, so things can, so in the waterfall system, if you've got safety critical, and you don't know the user, for example, you don't know the user, then you don't have the user go to interact or react, then there's a problem. Okay. So we're all seeing on these big safety critical systems like interfaces to aircraft and these kind of things, we're all seeing increases in the kind of way that things are done because they learn from a real version, a released version of the last aircraft. That is true, so you need to know, and that's why things have been created such as the NASA TLX scale, which looks at workload. So cognitive workload scale, so therefore you can, you know, if you're NASA and send people to space, you can do some tests and find out what the cognitive workload is in different computational machinery. So that's why we have those, that's very true. So this says, if you're going to use the waterfall process for things like, for developing, say, critical systems where humans are involved, you better be damn sure you know the human at the start. Okay, even though that's not in the waterfall life cycle directly, the understanding of the human at the beginning, the users at the beginning, is really critical because it's difficult to do afterwards. Okay, what about Spiral? What might we use Spiral for? I should have a show of hands. Who's using? So for your third year projects, who's using waterfall for your third year project? Ooh, one person, but you're too scared to put your hand up.
No, I'm not, he's just joking.
He's just joking. Okay, that's one person. Spiral?
No, waterfall.
Waterfall, okay, waterfall. So you're in your own little room doing your own work.
I just do everything, I don't care.
Spiral. I hope you can justify that by doing your report when you do your third.
No,
report.
I'm going to say that I have to use agile, but.
I'm not your second marker, so I know nothing, I've not heard this. I'm just going to top the tape. Iterative. Okay, lots of people are using iterative. So why are you using iterative then? Yes?
Because I'm going to have contact with users, and it's likely that what I build is not going to be suitable for users, but they may not get the experience that I want them to get from it on the first kind of build.
Right, good. So generally that's a good reason to use iterative for you, because you've decided that you don't know everything at the time you start out. And then you're going to implement stuff and see where you get to in the next situation because you don't know everything. Okay. Yes.
Each iteration of my project requires the previous result, so I need the sort of building block before we do the next.
Okay. So you need So you need the next. You need one result after the next and the building block kind of structure. Very good. Yes.
Every time you deliver something, you have a feedback cycle. So like if you spot something that's not quite the way it should be, for example, if you have a customer.
So generally you've got feedback at the end of each iteration and then you can make changes as you go, which is a really good idea. Okay, very good. Okay, so iterative, good. What about things like the rational unified process or Scrum? Why aren't you using Scrum in your project? So, do you know what Scrum is? It's a form of Agile. Yeah?
Agile methodology.
So, Agile methodology, yeah.
It's better with teams.
It's better with teams, that's right. So, because in your projects there's just one of you, mainly, I'd imagine, Scrum is better in teams because you need these stand-up meetings, you need to do sprints and all this kind of stuff, okay? Also, no, I keep using, calling users pigs, really. It's a weird thing to do. Anyway, so yeah. So I think that you seem to be picking it because it allows you flexibility. It means that you've decided that you don't know everything at the start of the project. Whereas Waterfall makes a statement that you do know everything at the start of the project. Seems to me that Waterfall, built in the 60s, had a certain mindset of the 60s that the scientists and engineers knew everything because they were in charge. That's where the power base was. This iterative seems to be a far more useful thing to do because it suggests that we don't know everything, that people and systems change, okay, over time. All right, good. Okay, so developing from user experience. So here's my top two. If you're going to develop a user experience in a research and development context, so cowboy coding. This is the thing, if you're going to do research and development in the context of user experience, I suggest you use cowboy coding. Has anybody heard of the cowboy coding? Yes, go on.
The kind of way you just go into it and see what happens.
Yeah, it's just where you go into and see what happens. The thing about research for development for user experience is that you don't really know what you're doing when you start, okay? You've just got some general ideas, some general thoughts, get on with it, okay, and see what happens. You need to get something going, probably, if you want to do some testing. Okay? So, who's heard of the Skunk Works? Yeah, you know all this stuff. Let's have somebody who's. Anybody else know what Skunk Works? What Skunk Works is? Okay, go on then. Tell me what Skunk Works is.
So, it was a Lockheed Martin facility where they designed crazy aircraft like the Blackbird and the Blackboard.
That's right. So, Skunk Works. Are these places where they create or used to create crazy sort of well in this case Skunkworks was the first one, airplanes, okay, that no one knew whether they fly or crash or anything else like that. And also Skunkworks is a term that's been created now for very extreme research, if you like. So for instance the Google project that developed Google Glass was for the So generally, you've got those kind of things in there. And this is very useful. Cowboy coding, if you go at it and hope you're right, is a very good thing to do it. It's good because you've got no fixed plan. So you can do whatever you like. And in academia, oftentimes we do have a fixed plan, but it's not so formal, okay, as a standard development environment. The same is true for no admin. So you've got very little admin to do, very low overheads of admin you want in cowboy coding. You don't want lots of meetings, you don't want lots of scrums and sprints. What you want to do is just code steadily along and you'll come out with something at the end of it which will be falling to pieces, held together with twine and string and bits of sticky tape, if you like, but it'll allow you to do some prototypical testing to get to a development version. Okay. The outcomes are uncertain. Most of the time in standard research and development work, especially research work, 90% of the things we start don't ever go anywhere. Okay? And that's academia, 90% we start don't ever go anywhere. It's just that the 1% that we do means everything. Okay? So that's the issue. You don't know what you're doing when you start. But where? Tim Berners-Lee didn't really know what he was doing when he started. And then you get the World Wide Web, and that's the 1% that makes everything else good, because that 1% has paid for every piece of your real life, well, you might realize this, but the World Wide Web, the money that's been generated so far from the World Wide Web, the finances from it, pays for every piece of research that has ever occurred from today backwards. Every piece of research, everything that's been developed on the planet in research terms has been paid for already by the World Wide Web. By the funds that have been generated by the World Wide Web, because it's so pervasive and so much money has been generated by it. And that's one piece of research and survey. Okay, if I was developing in an actual development scenario where I've got customers, where I want to make a product that's actually out there, then I'd use an agile kind of system. So I'd use iterative, but I use other kind of agile. Scrum's quite good if you are in a team, if you are in a team, I think. And these are the four parts. So we know where Agile was created, right? The Agile Manifesto, you've heard of it, I think. The Agile Manifesto?
Yeah.
Yeah? Of course you've heard of it, but nobody's shaking their head in the air. They're just going, sure, you're on the back table. Okay, so the Agile Manifesto. Individuals and interactions over process and tools. So that's a bit all that goes from UX. It's about individuals and interactions. Okay. Working software. That's what we're interested in. Working software allows us to test it, to change it quickly. Customer collaboration over contract negotiation. Quite obviously, that's what we want in the user experience. We don't want to negotiate contracts, because contracts are created at a higher level than users. Okay? Collaborations with users means that you get software that works, and then you get paid for it. And responding to change over following a plan. Now, this means that if you've got waterfall, you don't change the plan. You can't change the plan. Okay, that's how you're going to get paid for a start. But if you've got this, you are changing the plan to a certain set of parameters. So, my advice. Developing for user experience in a research setting is PowerPoint, because you don't know what you're doing, mostly. If it's in a development setting, think about using Agile. Okay. The other thing you should think about is separation of concerns. So we've heard about separation. We've heard about separation of concerns in your software engineering, haven't we? Yeah? Okay, good. So powering along. So if we're separating concerns, we want to think about different kinds of ways to do that. So here we've got MVC. Here's a bit of MVC. We're all the model view controller. So model view controller allows us to separate concerns. What we're trying to do at the interface level, for you guys, user experience people, interface developers, people doing what's called interaction design, is to separate concerns such that you separate program logic from the interface functionality. You're trying to decouple program logic from interfaces. That way, you can create interfaces while somebody else does the program logic at the back. You can test the interfaces, and the interfaces are more malleable than if you build an interface with program logic. So if you're using Visual Basic, using Visual Basic or something like this, the interface is conjoined to the program logic. Okay? And it's generated that way. And that's a problem if you're trying to push out what you built to Android, say, something like this. But there are toolkits, plenty of toolkits that allow you to do this decoupling, if you think about it. Okay. What's solar? Yeah?
Separation of aspects.
The separation of aspects, that's a good one for aspect-oriented computing, yes?
Service-oriented
architectures as well, so there's two things here. Service-oriented architecture. So therefore, what we're saying is that functionality is a service. The functionality, the program logic, is a service to be called by the interface. Okay, that means the interface can change, but the program logic stays the same, because to it, it's just a service. Who's heard of RESTful interfaces, RESTful APIs? Okay, so RESTful APIs do just this. As do what else is there? Remote procedure calls. All of these things don't prejudge an interface. Okay, they don't judge how the interface is going to be generated, how the data is going to be displayed mostly. They're just spitting back some functionality that you've asked for, okay? Some output. And that's a useful thing. That's what you should be doing, separating concerns in user experience work, because it allows you to do two things. It allows you to develop the interface and change it and test it with users, just the interface itself and how it looks, very quickly, because you're not relying on any coding in the background. And it also means that you can move that interface between application domains, between platforms. So you might have a platform which is platform as a service, like Google Engine and that kind of thing. You might want to move that onto a different kind of platform. You might want to move it to Android or something like this. How much easier to do that if you're separating these concerns? Okay. So how do we do this? Well, there's ways of doing it. We've got WIMPs, Windows Icons, Menus, and Pointing Devices. These are the standard GUIs that we would use today. And in fact, when it comes to dividing the interface, it's really important that you realise that unless you're working for somebody like Google, or working for somebody like Apple, or Windows, or you know Microsoft, a big corporation like this, interface design really isn't done anymore, apart in any of the non-large players. Okay, so if you're designing the interface components, the toolkits, that's mainly done now at the people who own the platforms, or often products. Okay. So how things look, because what we're all doing is we're working to a specification, an interface specification, how things should look. Even if it looks wrong, it still looks the same as all the others, so people get used to the way that the mode of use. Okay, so that's what we need to think about. The only place that interfaces are really moving now is on the web, because there's no holistic view. Okay, so on the web, interfaces are changing. Lots of interface design going on, but not really at the application domain level. That's because the interface specification has been set by platform vendors, okay? So the OS vendors. All right, so we've got GUIs and widgets. So we know about GUIs and widgets. I presume you also know about skins and wrappers. Okay, so where you've got same functionality but you want to reskin it, so it looks cool, it looks slightly different. You can do that with lots of stuff, with lots of kinds of applications and lots of kinds of operating systems. And here's one which I really like, but it looks like a really horrible thing when it's generated. The user interface gets generated from functional descriptions. So generally, if you've got a set of functions that you want to enact, and we know what's expected to go into that function and what's expected to come out of that function to be displayed, then we can generate some interface components by understanding what inputs are required and what presented information can come back. And that means that information can be, if we group together a set of functions, we can generate an interface based on that. However, you must have an additional step whereby you arrange it, because generally you don't do a very good job of arranging this functionality together, or the presentation, just really horrible. Okay, so how can we do this? How can we do these things? How can we separate things? Well, as I said before, we've got remote procedure calls. So have you used remote procedure calls before, anybody? Yeah, one, two, three, okay. So you've got remote procedure calls, so that's kind of what you're doing. You know, also when you've got web APIs where you're sort of going to try and connect to Twitter, you're saying to Twitter, Twitter say to you, give me this information, I'll give you back something that you know is a well-defined piece of presentation information, and you display it how you like on what device you like. Okay? So also representational scope transfer, RESTful interfaces. Some people might not really use this. What about WSDL? Anybody heard use WSDL? One, two, okay, yeah, so three. So WSDL seems to be mainly used. These ones seem to be the kind of bad boys of, or girls, whatever, bad people of API stuff. So they're quite, these guys live in the Northern Quarter, if you like, whereas these guys live in Didsbury, sort of thing. Okay, so generally, these web service description language, they're quite good, they're quite, they're used in corporates like IBM and Fujitsu, and these are the aerospace industry, whereas these guys kind of used in startups and edgy kind of things, because they're more malleable to change, and you don't even agree with description language. Okay? These ones are seen as being far more IBM, if you like, far more of a higher stature, whereas these are seen as being far more agile to move. So I like using these, because I don't like using them. So that's one. Okay. So we're coming to the close, which is good, because we've got a few minutes of questions afterwards. So here's what I think you ought to be thinking about when you think about UX and the development methods you have. And really, this is kind of, I get in some ways, I'm preaching to the choir, because I'm preaching to people who are already convinced about this. I imagine you're obviously good software engineering and agile development. Who disagrees with open, agile, and participatory as a user experience thing? Should we have closed systems? Who's read The Cathedral and the Bazaar? What? Nobody else has read The Cathedral and the Bazaar. Read The Cathedral and the Bazaar. Okay? It's an awesome book on code. Okay, and so this is comes from a guy, Eric Raymond, who wrote an original piece called Homesteading the New Sphere. Okay, so how do we settle this new sphere? This is olden days term for the web, okay, for the net.
I can't find the network for
net. What is that? What is that? Attention all the time. Kids today, they just got multiple attention. Very short attention. Okay, so Cathedral and the Bazaar has two things. It says that you can work in a cathedral or a bazaar. So we can think that software engineers are the high priests of everything that happens. We can think of development and user experience as the experts, the high priests of all this, of how things work. And they all are in the cathedral. Everything's closed. People on the outside shouldn't know about it. You shouldn't be able to use their stuff, okay? And then there's this other idea of the bazaar, where, I mean, in the cathedral, everything's well regulated, okay? There's going to be a procedure to do everything so that you're able to make sure that you all understand what you're supposed to be developing, okay? However, the bazaar says, we already know. We want everybody to try and, help us out. We want people to, if they've got a good idea, we want them to react it in our software. If they want to test or break our software, we want them to test or break our software in ways we couldn't imagine. Okay? We might want to use our software in ways that we couldn't imagine. Twitter never expected that we'd be using their platform to send messages between servers about how well the server's doing, if you like. What's its maintenance cycle? Does it require anything? All these things are. They are news. So this kind of stuff is really certainly when this book was written, this was still in flux. People were mainly in a closed system. Okay, and people outside of computer science, okay, so first of all, who thinks open, agile and participatory is the way to go with software engineering in today's world? I'm biased in the idea because what about who thinks closed, fixed, and non-participatory is the way to go in this world, in the new software engineering world? Nobody. And there's some people in the middle who are just too. Okay, you're a thinker on your own, but that's good. So you'll notice outside in the world beyond us. That this secondary view, closed, not agile, and not participatory, is what most people think. Okay? The University for Modern buys Microsoft, as its email comment, getting rid of the open source systems because it couldn't do the dialogue probably. Of course, they couldn't do the dialogue, but it's just a thought, it's just a perception. Okay? If you buy Microsoft, it's a closed system, but you can guarantee it. It won't change, it's not agile, but it won't change. We can't add to Outlook. We can't contribute to it. But that's okay.
But
they don't want to participate.
You can
got from a laptop, you know where to go and like ask. So if I ask you to reach on laptop, I go to Martin and say, hey, I paid a couple of millions for outlook for the movie university, so.
You know what they said about? Oh, we're fixing
yeah.
the same as everybody else, so yeah, nothing much.
I'm not just saying.
So generally that's I mean you're right sometimes in the open world it's, you know, there's nobody to ask, you have to just fix it. Okay. Yeah. Same as Blackboard. I mean the reason why my slides, I mean okay, you have to do testing on Blackboard, but the reason why my slides are on Blackboard is because I want to go to learning experience on them to see these things. I don't want it to be behind a Blackboard paywall. Okay. That's why it's not on Blackboard. Okay, because that's hemmed in. It's not open. It's not agile and it's not participatory. But most people have, but we bought it because people wanted a system that was closed. Because that closed is good, we can control it. Closed means we can control it. Yes?
If it was open, you might not sell as many copies.
That's true. You might not sell as many copies, but even more, the people who were buying it want it to be closed. So the university wants it to be closed, not because they're going to sell, meaning they have to pay money for a year for it. Right?
But
it's a lot of money we're paying for the service, but we want it to be closed because we want to control the content. You know, we want to control that. We want to control the agile development. The agile range is not agile, it doesn't change, but we don't want it to change. You know, we want it to be very slow and change. And we also want there to be no participation in changes to it. Okay? Because we want to be given what we do and we conform to it. And that might be right in some cases, although you'll notice from my direct drive I'm slightly biased on this, so there we go. That's why I saw you use Moodle, because a lot of people here are like, you know, are kind of biased with it as well. Okay. So read this book and you'll be able to understand more about what I'm ranting on about with regards to the development life cycle. So, next week, we're about done. Next week, read the next chapter, okay, with your notes. Be ready to answer the chapter self-assessment questions. Next time, there are two sets of self-assessment questions. The first ones are for this week, chapter one, and the second one's for chapter two. Okay, so we're going to have two sets of self-assessment questions. We're going to do the pop quiz, two pop quizzes next time. If anyone's got any problems, you should be getting your feedback in a week to 2 weeks for your coursework. If anybody's got any problems, they need to see me about it. If you want to see me, you can come and talk to me now, which is best. I've got an open house on Fridays, 2 until 6. However, if you come at 6, if you come on a week, then I'll do it for you. So, but generally, come at 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9. You can get the free coupon, and when you click the free coupon, okay, go away. Have some